Está aquí, la sala.
Sí. So before we start the seminar today, as always, to welcome new people to the institute, we have Ernesto Nicola.
Ernesto Nicola comes. He's just joining us from the Max Planck Institute in Dresden, working on biological physics and studying with a high dog for 3 years.
And the other people to welcome today is José Zunino. He is from the CONICET in Argentina, from the Centro de Investigaciones Ópticas, and he will be visiting us for a year with a postdoctoral fellowship from CONICET. He's been working essential information theory and analysis of temporal series modes in the context of optics and nonlinear dynamics of optical systems, and that's one of the things that we will be doing here. And I want to call your attention that this last paper that I know of, one is in the inefficiency of the stock market, and the other has to see with information theory and the classical quantum transition. So, it's interesting, so probably in the not only optics.
Should we say something to all the series in there?
Oh, yes. Thank you. And at 7:30 today, 7:30 p.m. today, there is a talk by Tomás Sintes that's in downtown in the old building of the university, and it is the first of three talks, which are outreaching talks for general public. But I think all of you would benefit from listening to these talks and having a wider perspective, things that people at the institute do. And so your attendance to this. To be started with the highly appreciated, but they are not in English.
Okay, so we now continue with our series of weekly seminars, and today we have Maria Moreno with us about photonic crystals acting on instabilities and squeeze states in open. So, go ahead.
I was wondering if Pera would be here.
No. Pera is in Formentera. You know, some people go to Formentera, some people attend a seminar. He's giving a talk in Formentera.
Okay, for the clear. Then, as Damian said, I'm going to present today the work related to how photonic crystals act on instabilities and squeeze state in optical parametric oscillator. This work has been performed in collaboration with Miguel Ángel García Marc and Damian Gomila under the supervision of Roberta Zambrini. So the outline of the talk is the following. We are going to describe firstly the prototype system with a briefly introduction to the instabilities occurring in optical parametric oscillators. Then we are going to see how photonic crystals may control the optical parametric oscillator instabilities, and later on we are going to focus in the expression of quantum fluctuations and in the fact if the photonic crystal may improve these quantum fluctuations. So, as we said, we are going to focus in an optical parametric oscillator with this sketch here. It's a mirror cavity embedded in a nonlinear quadratic crystal that performs parametric down conversion. We are going to be interested in the degenerate case in which the pump has frequency 2 omega and signal have frequency just half, so omega. These are common devices for frequency conversion and squeeze state generation. Also, it is well known that spontaneous pattern formation takes place in optical parametric oscillators. We are going to speak first about this phenomena, and later on, in the second part of the talk, we are going to speak about squeeze state generation. So, spontaneous pattern formation is an universal phenomena appearing not only in nature, as in biological and chemical systems, but also in non-linear optical devices. Here, On the left, we have a picture from the Belousov Chaotinsky reaction that showed a chemical pattern, a spontaneous pattern. And here we have a picture of the transfer profile of a light emerging from a Kerr cavity, a sodium vapor. Optical parametric, spontaneous pattern formation in optics was predicted in 1987 by Guillaton and Lefebvre. We see the equations they introduced for the evolution of the electric field contains all the ingredients necessary for the spontaneous pattern formation. Here we have losses, here we have the input field, here we have the coupling terms, here the non-linearities, here we have the tuning, and here the diffraction, which is really important because it allows the spatial coupling. This is a non-linear phenomena. For instance, if we plot the output signal as a function of the input pump, we see that there is a threshold. And above this threshold, parametric, that is the parametric down conversion, and the pattern formation has the take place. So both thresholds coincide. Then, above threshold, as we said, the pattern is formed and it will have a critical width number as we will see later, which is related to the signal that you need. So in order to describe a spontaneous pattern formation, we need a spatial multimode description. Let's see how is this description. Let's put the equation. This is a review about this optical parametric oscillator classical equations. We have here the evolution of the pump field and the signal field. As a function of the transfer profile coordinate and the time. Here we have losses, here we have the detuning, here we have diffraction, here this is the input field, and here we have the nonlinear coupling term. These equations, in order to get these equations, we have done a slowly varying amplitude, parachain and mean field approximations. So if we do a linear stability analysis of the optical parametric oscillator without photonic crystal, we look for the stationary and uniform solution. These are the trivial ones for the pump and for the signal. We linearize around them and then we obtain a eigenvalue problem in the Fourier space. It is well known that in order to know the stability of a solution, we see the sign of the eigenvalues. So when the eigenvalue, these are real eigenvalues by the way, all of them are real. So if the eigenvalue is negative, then the solution is stable and the other way around. So we care about the sign of this eigenvalue. Then we see the square root and we try to see which value of E, the injected pump, minimize this eigenvalue, and then we obtain the pump threshold. First of all, we see that the detuning of the pump only affects the threshold, just increasing the threshold. Then we focus in the other part of the product and we see that in order to minimize, we can have two situations in which the first one in which the detuning of the signal is positive or equal zero, then the K, the wave number, is just zero. So I'm pumping the device and then I'm getting a signal with a K, a wave number equal zero, so just a plain wave. That's all. But in order to minimize the pump, to get the pump threshold. In the case in which the detuning is negative, then the minimum happens when the wave number has this value, the square root of minus the detuning of the signal over 2. So again, I have my device, my optical parametric oscillator, I'm pumping the system, and then I get a signal, but this time the signal forms a streak pattern with a critical wave number. A streak pattern with a critical wave number. This was reported in 1994 by Gianluca and collaborator. Then, once we have reviewed what happened in the optical parametric oscillator, let's put the novelty of our prototype system. We want to include a photonic crystal. So, the photonic crystal will be modeled as a modulation of the refractive index in the transfer profile. So, just a sketch here, a one-dimensional photonic crystal with periodicity lambda pc. So there are regions which have one refractive index and other regions with another refractive index. If we have a traveling wave with this exact relation between the lambda, this is the wavelength of the wave is twice the periodicity of the photonic crystal, then happens it happens that the maxima may be in the region with this refractive index, and at the same time some nodes are also in the same region. So that means that these two waves are traveling with different velocities, that means a split in energy that translates into a dispersion diagram which presents a bundle. So, waves fulfilling this condition for the wavelength must fulfill this condition for the wave number, and they are inhibited because they are in the center of the bundle. So the photonic crystal does not allow them to propagate. Okay, then how the photonic crystal come into the equations? Okay, photonic crystal translates into a modulation of the electronics in this way. KPC is the wave number of the photonic crystal. Here we have the two modulations of the amplitude of the modulation of the photonic crystal. So in the case in which M0 and M1 is 0, we don't have photonic crystal. In the following, we are going to present results concerning these four configurations. Without photonic crystal, will appear in black. With photonic crystal only affecting the signal, will be in green. Photonic crystal only affecting the pump will be in red. And with photonic crystal affect both fields, the results we are going to present will be in orange. So these are two examples of real pictures taken first on the left from a two-dimensional photonic crystal, and on the right from the transverse profile of a light coming out from an open optical parametric oscillator. Here we put this in order to see that they are both of order of microns, so the dimensions are compatible. Once we have finished with the description of our prototype system, let's go to how the photonic crystal acts in the control of instabilities.
Excuse me.
Sure.
In the
previous one?
In the picture on the right, there is no photonic crystal. It's only.
Yeah, that's right. Optical parametric oscillator. That's right. Thank you. So let's start showing some results. These are going to be our results. But first, I want to report. I want to do a review about one out former results. So in 2004, this paper appears in which the instability inhibition due to photonic crystal was predicted. It has been related. This paper was about a Kerr cavity. 1 year later, there was this paper showing, reporting same results about an optical parametric oscillator. Both systems are single resonant. That means that only one field, only one frequency is under consideration. So we see here the photonic crystal, we say that inhibit the pattern formation. So the pump threshold, let's remind that the threshold are the same, the parametric threshold and the spontaneous pattern formation threshold, they coincide. So we just call it threshold. So the pump threshold, as a function of the photonic crystal amplitude modulation, we see that when we don't have photonic crystal amplitude modulation, we don't have photonic crystal here. And then by increasing the amplitude of the modulation, we obtain that the pump rises. So there is inhibition. Our system is different. We have a double resonant system, so we can play with the pump and with the signal. So we will find a different scenario. Sorry, before my different scenario, I have to say that this prediction was experimentally confirmed by two different groups in these two recent papers. So here we see that in the near field, that means the real space, we have a pattern without photonic crystal, this is a striped pattern, and in the Fourier transform of the real space, that is called far field, we see a critical wave number here, corresponding to the wave number of the pattern, and the homogeneous component. But when we put the photonic crystal, experimental works have proven that there is no pattern and only the homogeneous component appears. So now I'm going to report my results. So we can play with both fields, the pump and the signal. And now I am going to focus in the results concerning the case in which the signal is at the center of the photonic crystal backup. So here. This means that KPC, the photonic crystal wave number, is twice the critical wave number, the wave number of the signal. So when we plot the pump threshold as a function of the amplitude modulation at the frequency of the signal and the pump, so again, when these two quantities are zero, we have the case in green, in the point, green point, so we don't have photonic crystal, we see that by increasing the modulation in the signal, we have inhibition, and we recover the results given in 2004. Only inhibition, the threshold rise. But by looking at the looking in this axis, we see that by increasing the modulation in the pump frequency, the amplitude modulation of the photonic crystal at the pump frequency, we obtain inhibition. The threshold is lower here. We can understand this phenomena taking into account that if this is the relation between the photonic, sorry, this is the relation between the wave number of the pump and the signal. So the wave number of the pump is twice the wave number of the signal. So if here we have this, don't care about the units, it's just like qualitatively. If here is the wave number of the wavelength, actually, of the pump, the big one in black is the signal. In the case in which we are in this, we have the signal in the center of the photonic crystal bundle, we have the relation, so we have a resonance between the pump wave number and the photonic crystal wave number, which is written here, which is plotted in dust blue line. So then there is a resonance between the photonic crystal and the pump that excites the phenomena, the parametric down conversion and the spontaneous pattern formation. So let's have a look to the efficiency of the processes in presence of the photonic crystal. So we plot the intensity of the pump as a function of the input. And here the signal intensity as a function of the input. First of all, we see that by increasing the input energy, there is a threshold, different threshold for each configuration, because as we said before, the photonic crystal moves the thresholds, and makes that the intensity of the pump goes to the signal, generate the signal. So the efficiency we see is the slope of the curves. Dots are the theoretical results for the case with a photonic crystal coming from the linear instability analysis we reported before. So they match perfectly with the curve without photonic crystal, which is in black. As we said before, yeah, this is the value. Okay, so in first approximation about the efficiency, what can we say? That the efficiency only depends on the distance of the threshold. The slopes are more or less, well, in first approximation, they are preserved. Further above threshold, if we increase 50% above threshold, we see that the efficiency slightly changes depending on the amplitude modulation of the photonic crystal. We see now a small change in the efficiency. So, we have reported now what happened in the case in which the signal is at the center of the photonic crystal backup. And we demonstrate that we have inhibition and also stimulation. Let's go to the case in which the signal is outside the photonic crystal backup. That means this here, in some region here in this line, and we choose this case in which the photonic crystal wave number is exactly the critical wave number, the wave number of the signal. So again, we plot the pump threshold as a function of the amplitude modulation of the photonic crystal at the frequency of the signal and at the frequency of the pump. Again, we have a zero in the case in which there is no photonic crystal, and we only have an inhibition. The pump is rising all time for every value, for any pair of values. But when we compare this graphite with the former one, we find that the inhibition in this case, in which the signal is outside the photonic crystal, we see that in this case, in which the signal is in the center of the photonic crystal bandgap, has inhibition weaker than in the case in which the signal is at the center, is out the center of the photonic crystal background. What is quite surprising, because we know that the photonic crystal inhibit the wave number. So how can happen that we have a stronger inhibition in the case in which the signal is out the photonic crystal background? In order to see this effect also, we have plot here a cut this the threshold as a function of M1 in the case in which M0 is 0, so just a cut like that, these two together, and the other way around. And we see effectively that the case in which the photonic crystal, the signal is out the photonic crystal band gap, is goes to 2, goes rise more than in the other case. So in order to understand this, we have a look to the intercavity pump energy. So we plot the intracavity pump energy. How much energy is coming into the device? In the case in which the signal is at the center of the photonic crystal band gap, we see that in below threshold, all the intensity as a function of the input field, they match, they are the same. All the energy is coming into in the four configurations. But in the case in which the signal is outside the photonic crystal band gap, we see that there is a loss, the energy is not coming into. The intracavity pump energy for these configurations is lower. So we interpret that as an effective detuning that creates a stronger inhibition. In fact, if we plot the intensity of the pump as a function of the input field for different values of the pump detuning, again, is the this equation comes from the linear stability analysis we saw before. We have in the black line the case in which we have the tuning equals 0, and that, by the way, is the case of all my results. All the results I have shown here, we always take the tuning of the pump equals 0. But if we increase the tuning of the pump, we see an effective a loss of energy. The intracavity energy is less, the intensity is less. So once we have understand this phenomena, let me show you what we are, it's a work in progress, but what happened when we are in a different configuration. That is, when the signal of the detuning, is zero. So we said before that sometimes when the detuning of the signal is negative, I pump my device and then I get signal with a pattern, forming a pattern. But when the detuning of the signal is positive or zero, then the wave number is zero, so the signal emerges as a plane wave. Then we don't have pattern anymore. And so we plot here the signal field, the real part of signal field, as a function of the input field. And we see here a different bifurcation diagram than before. The instabilities can become even, they can pass from supercritical, as we had before, to even here, to subcritical. But this work is still in progress, therefore showing that there are a lot of dynamics here going on. So let's go to another part of the talk about the squishing of quantum fluctuations. We are interested in the quantum properties of our system. Then a proper formalism is required. In fact, there is a standard procedure that allows us to calculate the bosonic correlation. The bosonic correlations between, we have bosonic fields describing our electric field. So we can calculate the correlation between these bosonic fields numerically in a first principle model. So how can we do that? Okay, we start from the von Neumann equation for the density operator. For an upper system, we can obtain the master equation that, thanks to the quasi-probability distributions, in particular we are going to use the Q representation, give us a Fokker panic equation equivalent to Langevin equation, which, as sure you know better than me, they are stochastic differential equations suitable to numerical simulation. So let's apply this formalism to our system. We have this Hamiltonian consisting in three parts. The linear part, the interaction part. Here we have the parametric down conversion in the degenerate case. We have here the creation of two photons at frequency of the signal times the annihilation of one photon at the frequency of the pump. And here we have the external field, that is the input. Creation here, the input field. So, doing the procedure we said before, we obtain this Langevin equation in the Q representation for the evolution of the pan and the evolution of the signal. Again, as we said before, we had losses, the detunings, the diffraction term, the input field, the non-linear couplings term, and we have noise modeling the quantum fluctuations. It is worth to remark that this noise is phase sensitive and multiplicative. Again, the photonic crystal coming to the equations in this way, modulating the detunings. Thank you.
Why is multiplicative? So what is the dependence on the alpha?
Yeah, I didn't show it here, but if you calculate the correlations, as they are complex noises, they are not the same. The correlation between the pre-alpha and the pre-alpha, you know what I mean? And I didn't show it here, you're right, it could be.
No, this is phase sensitivity, but you mean that the correlations also depend on alpha 0 and alpha 1?
Yeah, sure.
Workload.
That the noise depend on alpha 0 and alpha 1.
But it is not written there.
No, it's not written, sorry. You're right. Yeah, it should be here a part of that.
And how do they depend linearly?
It's a down of the... No. Yeah, it's happening by you, actually.
Principle of authority.
the noise in the pump is just not multiplicative, just additive one Gaussian noise. In the second noise in the C1 there is independence of alpha zero and is not linear, but is alpha zero is not changing too much, so there is not a very rich effect due to the multiplicative character of the noise.
So once we have described our quantum formalism, let's go to the quantum phenomena we are interested in, that is squeezing. So within the second quantization formalism, it is possible to describe the electric field as a combination of these two quadratures that are the canonical position and the canonical momentum. They are conjugate. They don't commute, so they must obey the Eisenberg uncertainty principle. That means that the fluctuations of the quadrature, that means the square root of the variance of each quadrature, must be bigger or equal than one. States that minimize this principle and that they have the same fluctuations in both quadratures are called coherent states, and they are the closest quantum states to classical ones. The fluctuations do not depend on time, and they are the same in both quadratures. And here, for example, no. In order to minimize the uncertainty principle, they must be one. So the representation of a coherent state in the phase, say, in the phase space, is a cycle. This cycle gives us the quantum limit or the classical limit. That also it is called some noise and also give us the vacuum fluctuations. What happens if one of the quadratures has a fluctuation which goes below these solenoid levels, for instance here, less than one, then the other one, in order to fulfill the Eisenberg principle, must be bigger. So then in the phase space diagram, in the phase space, we have an ellipse, which have a quadrature angle theta with respect to the horizontal axis. So we see that the fluctuations in this direction are damped, are squeezed, while fluctuations in the other direction are growing, are bigger. In terms of this theta, of this quadrature angle, we can build a generic quadrature in this way, that in the case in which theta is zero give us the position of the canonical position, I mean, and in the case in which theta is minus pi over 2, we get the canonical momentum. So with what is the condition for this quadrature to be squeezed? Because for these quadratures, we said that to be squeezed means that the fluctuation goes below the Sonoy levels or 1. For this quadrature, we have to calculate the variance in normal order. We remind that we are working with operators, so the normal, the order is quite important. And normally order is the natural photodetection and corresponds to the Peter representation, which is negative, is a quasi-probability, which is negative and singular. So, what happened with the variance in normal order, what happened when we calculate the variance of this quadrature normally ordered? It must be negative in order to get squeezed. The condition to be squeezed is when it's negative, and the maximum degree of squeezing is -1. There is an input-output formalism that gives me the possibility to calculate the squeezing outside the cavity that gives me a less range of squeeze. So, in order to be squeezed, this quadrature must have this normal order variance between 0 and -0.5. Yeah. So this is about single mode squeezing. And the Hamiltonian of this single mode squeezing is this one. That is also the Hamiltonian of the parametric down conversion in the degenerate case. We put it before. Here we are going to consider the case in which the bump is treated as a classical field, because we consider it strong enough to become undeflective in the parametric down conversion. So these are classical values for the pump, and here we have the signal generation, so we have two photon creation and the signal frequency, so the parametric down conversion. And the time evolution of the Hamiltonian gives us the squeezing generator. So, we see now here the relation between the parametric down conversion and the squeezing. In fact, because of that, we understand the squeeze state in an optical parametric oscillator that performs parametric down conversion. That's happened in one mode squeezing. Let's go to the two mode squeezing. So, we generalize. Now, instead of having only one field, one mode, degenerate, we have two. And the squeeze generator, coming from the evolution of the Hamiltonian, gives us this. So, if this quadrature was generated, so if this is the quadrature that becomes squeezed with this squeezing generator, this is the one that becomes squeezed for this squeezing generator, the two-mode squeezing generator. And we see that it's the quadrature of the superpositions. Again, theta is the quadrature angle, and we have two modes. The sum or the subtraction. It is in.
When you do this with a parametric optical parametric oscillator, you mean that you are now considering the non-degenerate case, that you have two frequencies. What are those two modes? Two different frequencies of the single field, or what are they?
That reminds me that this is just an example. Not only in optical parametric oscillator appears this Hamiltonian. Thank you for.
No.
And also, you say that.
What do you mean by two modes? If you will apply this to the optical parametric oscillators, what are the two modes? Two frequencies of the signal field, so in the non-degenerate case,
yeah.
Or two spatial modes of the,
yeah, good
the
point,
signal?
Good point. From the beginning, I said that we are going to work in the degenerate case. In that moment, meaning that we don't consider the signal and we only have one, the signal. We don't consider either and we only have the signal. So it's degenerate. Now, we come back to the two modes. Why? Now we have no degeneration. Why? Because now our fields are the same, it's still a signal, but they are degenerated in modes. We are going to work with two opposite modes. That's it, sorry. That here, in our quadrature, we have degeneration in the Fourier space. Sorry, my explanation.
Two spatial modes, two transverse spatial
modes. Two transverse spatial modes, sorry, my explanation. So, let me remark that the two modes squeezing is related to the EPR entanglement. So, this is our quadrature. We have the quadrature angle. We have the superposition angle between these two bosonic operators describing the signal field at two opposite modes in the Fourier space. And we said before, we want to calculate the variance of that quadrature We are interested in the case in which we are in the critical width number. It is worth to stress that squishing is a phenomena sensitive to the distance to the threshold. And we said before, photonic crystal moves the threshold. So all the results we are going to present here from the four configurations are related to a fixed distance to their corresponding threshold. In this case, 1% below. So we plot the variance of the quadrature at the critical width number. As a function of the quadrature angle for the superposition angle that minimizes the variance. In the following, we are going to present only results in the case in which the signal is at the center of the photonic crystal band. Then, as we said before, there are fluctuations that go below the solenoid levels, the quantum fluctuations, the classical limit, and the others become very big. No? We see here. We want to see the quantum fluctuations, so let's zoom this picture. We get this one from the other, and we see that the optical parametric oscillator in presence of photonic crystal present to most squishing. For configuration have the same maximum degree of squishing minus 0.5. But when we look at the intensity correlation, in particular the twin beam correlation, we saw that photonic crystal do not present that correlation. For instance, we plot here the difference between the intensity of the signal at two different opposite modes as a function of the wave number. We see that at the critical wave number, the correlations become even classical. They are positive. They are above the solenoid levels, which is the classical limit. So twin beam correlations are not preserved. This is due to secondary processes that photonic crystal excites. We have here the primary processes of the parametric down conversion. So we have one photon of frequency 2 omega, which is the pump, with a zero transfer momentum, which is split in two, with frequency omega and opposite wave number. Secondary processes, examples of secondary processes are below, and we see here that it's possible to create a wave number k and a wave number minus k that we calculate the correlation, but they come from incoherent deflections. So the correlation degrades the quantum correlation. They become classical. Yeah. So, to sum up this slide, below threshold, squishing is preserved in presence of photonic crystal, even if the twin beam correlations are degraded. But what we want to show you is what happens above threshold. So let's go to present about the threshold for all the configuration, but we are going to present here only this significant case in which the photonic crystal is affecting both the pump and the signal fields, in comparison to the case with a photonic crystal in black. We see that the variance as a function of the quadrature angle is widened in the presence of photonic crystal. Another way to see this phenomenon: if we plot the variance as a function of the quadrature angle and as a function of the superposition angle, and we consider that the darkest regions are at the minimum possible squishing, minus 0.5, and we consider that the squishing region are limited, but these green lines that are at the soft noise level, we see that without photonic crystal in black, there is a small region of squishing, while when we introduce the intracavity photonic crystal, we really have a bigger squish regions. So the photonic crystal allow us to improve the squishing. Why? What does happen? I mean, the reduction of the fluctuation. Why is four? Why you have the reduction of the fluctuation? Okay, we can. The physical reason of this phenomenon can be attributed to the fact that the photonic crystal breaks the translational symmetry. So it's well known that a system with translational symmetry preserves momentum, linear momentum. So we wanted to prove if the linear momentum was preserved. And I remind you that in optics, linear momentum is equivalent to the Poynting vector. So we calculated the transfer. I remind you, we are always in the transfer profile. We calculate the transfer Poynting vector, which has this definition. It can be shown that below threshold, without photonic crystal, in few modes approximation, the Poynting vector variance is related to the twin beam correlations. So we knew the twin beam correlations. So let's see. So we have the moment. The linear momentum is related to the point. The transverse linear momentum is related to the is equivalent to the transverse Poynting vector. And it can be shown that it's related to the twin beam correlations. The twin beam correlations below threshold have analytical results that give us minus 0.5 in the maximum value, but in this paper. And above threshold has this value, as it was it has been proved in this paper in numerical simulation. So. Without photonic crystal, or all of them is without photonic crystal. So we have here the results in the first column. We have the results without photonic crystal. We see that a fixed distance to the threshold, we see that below threshold and above threshold, our simulation, because these are numerical results, match to the analytical, here analytical result and here numerical result that give us the maximum minus 0.5. Numerical results about the other three configurations for a fixed value of the pump or also 1% below threshold and 1% above threshold shows that the variance of the Poynting vector is not the squeeze anymore. We see we don't have the minimum fluctuation. They fluctuate. They really fluctuate. So we lose the conservation of the momentum. The momentum is not conserved, so there is translational symmetry breaking due to photonic crystal. Another way to see this phenomenon is attending below threshold what happened with the diffusion, diffusive structures created by the wave numbers that are less damped below threshold. These are the wave numbers that will be selected above threshold to create the pattern. So they will be the wave number of the pattern above threshold. So if we plot here in the spatial coordinate, in the transverse spatial coordinate, as a function of time, so time versus space, this dissipative stratus called noisy precursors, in the case without a photonic crystal, or in the case in which the photonic crystal do not affect the pump, we have that they move, they fluctuate, but at the moment we put photonic crystal affecting the pump, we see that they become locked. So noisy precursors locked when photonic crystal affect the pump field. How is my time? I'm sorry, it's over?
It's okay, it's okay.
How much I have, sorry?
You have 15 minutes.
15 minutes?
If you want, sorry, you just finish.
Yeah, sorry, so we see that they become locked, they don't translate anymore, so the photonic crystal is breaking the symmetry. Yeah.
Okay. About simulation, now with which model? With the all your equations with the noise correlations given by quantum theory, or with some additive noise?
With phase sensitive multiplicity, yeah. So let's conclude about the instability session. We saw the possibility of controlling the parametric and the pattern formation instabilities through intracavity photonic crystal. The threshold can be either rising or lower. This is interesting. This is a quite interesting result because there is not other way to lower a threshold with a homogeneous detuning. That means without photonic crystal. In optical panoptic oscillator, there is not other way. Always it's easier to rise the threshold because then it means that you need more power or more effort in order to get your phenomena. But only with this photonic crystal, intercavity photonic crystal, you can lower the threshold. Concerning the quantum fluctuations, we saw that below threshold, the photonic crystal leaves two modes quadrature squeezing unchanged even in the presence of secondary processes worsening the intensity correlations. Yeah? And above threshold, as a novelty, what we obtain? By using an intracavity photonic crystal, we improve the performance of the optical parametric oscillator in generating a squeezed state. As the range, you remember here, as the range of quadrature squeezing angle is wider. So open questions are still in progress. About the stability threshold. Okay, we have to study, as I showed you before, the multistability regime. That was the case in which we had signaled tuning that they are non-negative. Also, we are interested in study the two-dimensional photonic crystal modeling. And another question is also to introduce a higher contrast in the photonic crystal modulation. So we put a sinusoidal, so we can have bigger difference between the maximum and the minimum amplitudes, or also just like sharper contrast. Relating to the quantum fluctuations, concerning the quantum fluctuation, in progress is the analytical solution of the quadrature squeezing for the optical parametric oscillator with photonic crystal below threshold. This, in fact, is the work that Miguel Ángel García March is doing that I didn't report here. And also, we are interested in the EPR entanglement. And that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. So, any more questions?
On the question of instabilities before the quantum machine, late 80s, there were quite a few works in which people, and what you are doing here is to try to understand the competition between a spontaneously generated wavelength and a wavelength imposed externally to the system. Okay? Now, that was done in a number of studies of pattern formation, for instance, in electrodynamic instabilities with spatially periodic electrical fields and things like that. Now the question is there anything new here, or how does this relate to that thing? Or?
I mean, nobody has said,
no one has studied previously this particular case. But I am asking, it's mm-hmm. about if there is anything different here of what was studied some 20 years ago in terms of competition of these two wave numbers.
I mean, for me, everything is new, you know? I don't know exactly what you mean about the former work, because maybe they were just single resonant, or...
It was not optics.
Ah, okay. You mean about looking, instability?
I'm looking at, you know, very far away. What is the question you address? The question you address is the competition of a wave number which is spontaneously generated by the system and a wave number which is imposed externally.
You're right.
That's the general question that you're addressing. Okay? That general question is not new. And what I'm asking is, from your particular example, is there anything new at the general level in this competition?
Can I get a joke here?
I don't think it was considered with the perspective of the inhibition.
Yeah.
I think there are most cases were considered in the case in which you are imprinting some substance similar to the pattern that was emerging, and then you were, in essence, stimulating the process. Here is exactly the opposite way. You are trying to use the Bangra principles, so you are using a wavelength that inhibits the pattern formation. Then, of course, here is more complicated because you have two wavelengths, and then you try to do one thing, and you also have the other one together. So this from one side. But still there is something that we didn't look at and should be really related to this in some way, even if it's not the same. That is in the optical case, in the case it was considered a case in which you were imprinting the pattern with the pump. In our case, the thing is in the tuning. So there are differences in that. You are not putting an energy profile inside the system with this shape. You are just shaping the system in a sense. Yes. So
my question was try to be constructive.
Maybe
you're doing a very particular type of system, very particular thing. I mean, probably one can cook up a very generic type of model in which one sees this competition and see what's new there.
I don't know, you know this literature better than me, but I don't think it was considered with the perspective of the manga being issued. So I think most of the time they were just imprinting the same pattern. So this should be new. Still, it would be interesting to look at it.
That's what I'm saying. If there is something new, say it in a language which people which are not interested in the OPO could.
And there's one to add something?
Yeah, a comment regarding to that. I think the difference is maybe that in those studies, you mean some things in where they have some, they put some electrodes, right? I mean,
there were several theoretical experiments.
Exactly. And Tercullet had did some theory. Right?
And Jerry Goldberg, Francesca Reyes, and Simon.
The difference to that studies is that they have, without any forcing, they have anyway an instability. In this case, and that instability was appearing supercritical, and here I think it's different, right? I mean, because you're exciting externally the formation of the pattern, and then you're...
No, but the pump is homogeneous.
The
beauty is
pattern,
yeah. There is also a new line, I mean, along those lines there is some recent studies done in convection where they put some correlation on the plates. That's what was done in Göttingen, in Germany. I think this appeared the last year by Bodenschatz.
So it's not that old. It's still good.
Well, but this is like the other things were old, and this they are coming back to that problem, which was more disclosed.
Still, in this case, it would be interesting to look if they have been ever considering this scenario, so the scenario which you need because you are.
I mean, the thing on Bandrap is something very much from optics. You don't find this effect generally in a fluid thing when you put a periodic force on the lab. Because you need this interference of the complex field and so on. So it's not. So it's really. Well, yeah, this sound is really new.
Of course, and there are Bandraps in the show state.
Yes, more about that. Yeah, again, so this is hidden waves and so on. So not in general. More comments? No? If not, if anybody will have comments. Bien.
Esto ha sido trampa, María. La resta chapa sincera.
Ya.